Hello friends. In this video, we'll talk about a Zigbee sensor from the well-known manufacturer Mose, which is designed to measure light levels. Unlike motion sensors with built-in light sensors, the subject of this review transmits data much more frequently and is not tied to motion events. And presence sensors, which also sometimes include light sensors, require stationary power, while the subject of this review runs on a battery. In addition to the standard Tuya smart control system, we will test the device in many other systems, including using the Universal Matter protocol, as well as direct connection to alternative Zigbee coordinators. Before we begin, as usual, I ask you to like this video so more people interested in smart home topics can find it, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. Model, Mose ZSS, QY-L5C. Device type, light sensor. Protocol, Zigbee 3.0. Illuminance measurement range, from 0 to 1000 lux. Operating temperatures, from minus 10 to 50 degrees Celsius. Power supply, CR2032 battery, claimed battery life, 1 year. Size, 50 by 17 millimeters. The device comes in a small cardboard box, packaged in the standard style of this manufacturer's devices, many of which I've already reviewed. Check them out on my channel. The backside lists brief technical specifications, which I've already mentioned. And don't be put off by the relatively narrow measurement range, up to 1000 lux, while other sensors claim tens of thousands. A bit later I'll show you that this is more than enough. Let's take a closer look at what's included in the package besides the sensor itself. A pin, for resetting and switching to pairing mode. By the way, these are not always included, even when needed, but over time you end up with a whole collection of different pins. And a round piece of double-sided tape for mounting on a surface. A fairly detailed manual in several languages, the most comprehensive being in English. But I'll show all the main points in this video. Visually, the subject of the review reminded me most of the leak sensor from the same manufacturer. It has a round shape, with a small window for the light sensor in the center. There is also a row of holes, suggesting plans to release a combo device combined with temperature and humidity sensors. A bit later you'll see confirmation of this theory. On the back is the battery compartment cover, which is best opened with a coin. To the left of it is a hole. Beneath it is the reset and pairing mode button, which the pin is used for. Here is a comparison with the Mose leak sensor. For those interested, a link to its review is in the video description. The dimensions are identical, except it has a rubberized reset button on top and two metal contacts on the bottom. To prevent discharge during transport, a tab is installed between the battery. A CR2032 is used here, and the contacts, which needs to be removed before use. Let's move on to how the sensor works. The standard control system is Tuya Smart. The sensor will also work in Smart Life and the Mose app, which are essentially Tuya clones. To connect, you need a gateway. I'll be using a wired version that supports Zigbee, Thread, and Matter. A link to its review is also in the description. The device is identified correctly, a light sensor with an image that matches reality. Since the gateway supports Thread devices as well, the sensor tile displays the Zigbee interface icon. The plugin is quite simple. The main screen shows the light level in lux. You can go to the measurement history and view it by day, month, and year. On the settings tab, battery charge level and a toggle for low battery notification. Real-time readings. For this, I specifically walked around the apartment with the sensor through rooms with different lighting. There's nothing unusual in the general settings menu either. Device info, shared access, offline notification, firmware version check, and system removal. In automations, the sensor can only be used in the if section as a trigger. Two options are available, by light level and battery level. You set the required value and condition greater than, less than, or equal to it. When the set threshold is reached, the automation will trigger. For example, turning on an LED strip when the light level falls below 100 lux. Since the gateway the sensor is connected to supports matter, let's check the systems it is added to as a bridge. Let's start with Apple HomeKit. Go to the Hubs and Bridges menu, select this gateway, and go to the Accessories menu. Here, in addition to the previously connected plug, a device appeared that shows up as a temperature and humidity sensor with three sensors. Unexpectedly, upon closer inspection, it turned out that there is data for light levels, which corresponds to the current readings. On the right is a screenshot from the app taken at the same time, and the temperature and humidity data are zero. This confirms the combo sensor theory. The firmware is designed for three parameters, but the air parameter sensors are absent. In the Tuya app, the zero values are simply hidden. The main thing is that the light level data appeared in HomeKit and is displayed correctly. They can be used in automations. The next system where the gateway is connected via Matter is Google Home. Let me remind you that all connections work simultaneously. As expected, a combo sensor also appeared here, with zero temperature and humidity readings and current light level values. This is the light level display on the Google Nest screen. The temperature and humidity data just don't load. And the third system using this gateway as a Matter bridge is Home Assistant. So now the sensor can be used simultaneously in the four systems I just showed. And that's not the limit, by the way. The data is the same, two zeros and the light level reading. Here's a graph over a short period of time. The sensor responds quickly to changes in light levels, more than suitable for automations. Now it's time to move on to alternative Zigbee coordinators. As usual, we'll start with the Sonoff iHost smart home controller, to which Zigbee devices are connected directly. The current firmware version at the time of testing is 2.5.1. I start searching for new devices, disconnect the sensor from the gateway, and use the pin to put it into pairing mode. And there were no problems here either. The sensor was identified correctly. The E icon in the upper right corner indicates that this is an end device. The sensor tile also shows a battery level icon and current brightness readings. Apparently, iHost is able to work with such sensors, as there are no zero values for temperature and humidity, only brightness and battery level. Here, the history of readings over different time periods may also be available, and there is a data export button. In the settings, nothing special. You can view the manufacturer and device IDs, and the model. In automations, the sensor can also be used as a trigger, an event that causes it to fire. For this, you can set a brightness threshold greater than or equal to, or less than or equal to the specified value. Now let's return to Home Assistant, but instead of using the gateway in Matter Bridge mode, we'll use direct connection. Let's start with the standard integration for working with Zigbee devices, ZHA, and the SkyConnect USB coordinator. The connection process is standard. The sensor was identified, and it's clear that the integration detected quite a few entities, definitely more than it actually has. In addition to temperature and humidity, which we already saw when routed through Matter, another binary sensor appeared here, along with firmware version info. And under the battery level line, there is an identify button. Pressing it is supposed to help determine the specific device, usually causing the LED to blink, but in this case, it's just as useless an entity as the temperature and humidity values. Just in case, I'll show again how to disable unnecessary entities. We go into it. This is that unclear binary sensor. Click the gear icon. We get to the settings menu and disable this device. If needed, it can be enabled again the same way. In the end, I ended up with a device with two entities, brightness and battery level. The rest are simply not needed. The fact that the temperature and humidity sensors were automatically identified confirms the combo sensor theory once again. Now let's look at working with the Zigbee 2 MQTT add-on. At the time of testing, the current version was 2.2.1. A network Zigbee coordinator SMLite SLZB 06 is used. The sensor was added correctly, no external converters are needed. Full support is provided, including the appropriate icon for the sensor. This, by the way, is one of my working networks, since I got this sensor to use in one of the rooms. Extended device information. As I said, it was fully added to the system, taking into account all of its features. Therefore, just like in the native Tuya Smart app, unnecessary entities such as temperature and humidity are not displayed. This is how it looks in the MQTT integration, the same view I got when working through ZHA, only there I had to disable several entities. How I plan to use it. In one of the rooms, I have an Acura motion sensor installed, which is combined with a light sensor. It is aimed away from the window, which is behind it, toward the door, but the sensor always receives little light, and it can hardly tell the difference between when it's still light and when it's already dark. So, if it's configured to trigger in the dark, it still turns on the lights even when it's bright. That's why I decided to use a separate light sensor aimed at the window, in the opposite direction from the motion sensor. Only this way did I manage to make the automation work completely correctly, to turn on the light only when it's truly dark. Here for comparison, I combined on one slide the light readings of the Acura sensor on the left and the readings of the reviewed sensor taken at the same moment in time. The inward-facing sensor shows only 72 lux, and when it gets even darker, this value hardly changes. Meanwhile, the light sensor, with a current reading of 270 lux, thanks to being directed at the window, accurately responds to all changes. Here's how it looks in the interface. On the left, almost complete darkness, 2 lux, in the center, under artificial light from the chandelier, 119 lux, but note that it only sees the reflected light. On the right, I turned on a flashlight and pointed it at the sensor to display the maximum value of 1000 lux. As for the measurement scale up to 1000 lux, which might seem low compared to other sensors that can show values an order of magnitude higher. This is the daily history of readings during actual use of this sensor in a room. Even the peak value didn't exceed 400 lux. For example, another similar light sensor, but from Acura, with a larger measurement range, located in another room right on the window. Here the peak value was 1013 lux, slightly higher. But in practice, whether it's 1000, 1013, or even 5000, that's a value at which lighting doesn't need to be turned on. The more relevant range is actually from 0 to 100, maybe 200, which is used in automations. And this is an example of a template sensor that I use as a trigger for enabling the standby lighting. It turns on under the following conditions. The motion sensor is triggered, the light level is below 100. By the way, during experiments I arrived at a value of 30 lux, both lights in the room are off, and it's not nighttime. The last condition is needed so that the standby light doesn't turn on automatically at night and disturb sleep. The off sensor is much simpler. The light is on, but there is no movement, and it's not nighttime, since at night the lighting is only turned on manually, so it should also be turned off manually. In my case, the sensor did its job, and now the standby lighting automation works only when it's truly needed, not when everything is already well lit. And considering that I managed to grab it during an early sale for less than $4, the purchase was definitely worth it. By the way, I often post links to gadgets at early sale prices on my Telegram channel. That's all for now. I hope the video was useful and interesting for you. I would appreciate your likes. They help with promotion on YouTube. If you don't want to miss new videos, subscribe to my channel. In the video description, I'll leave links to all the resources mentioned, as well as to my Telegram channels and social networks, and groups for discussing smart home topics. Join in, it'll be interesting. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Peace to all.